Ham Radio Now, Episode 9, Part B, Before You Die. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. With me here is the bear. Say hi, bear. Sitting down here in my lap. Sorry to disturb you, bear. And behind me, yes, behind me is the mouse, one of our other blind tuxedo cats. We have three blind tuxedo cats here, totally. Before you die, can you talk about dying without getting maudlin? So I thought this episode would kind of stress my ability to conduct an interview that's fun and upbeat and, you know, kind of light and all that. Turns out, I did better than I thought. At least I think I did. I guess you'll be the judge of that once you've watched the episode. Now, I've known Chuck Littlewood, K4HF, for over 20 years. And Chuck is the go-to guy in this area for families who have had a death in the family, a ham has died, and they need help in disposing of the ham's equipment, you know, part of his estate. I knew Chuck had extensive experience with this, but I didn't know how extensive until I did this interview. I did think that he had some experience that Ham Radio Now viewers would appreciate hearing about, so we'll do that. And I talked to him at what is maybe a particularly appropriate venue at the QCWA booth at the local Raleigh Ham Fest. Now, the title of this episode, Before You Die, it's a little bit deceptive. I wanted to get your attention. But most of this is about what happens after you die. Well, there are some steps you can take to help your family before you pass on. And Chuck will give you some suggestions about that. So let's watch the interview. You wear a lot of hats, but there's one in particular that I want to ask you about that I think is pretty unusual in the world of ham radio. It may not be as unusual as I think, but you don't hear about it very much. You have somehow gained the reputation and the history of the guy who handles estates when a ham dies to help the family dispose of the ham equipment. I'm correct? That is
true? You're correct. Yep.
How did that happen? How did that come about? How long have you been doing it?
I've probably been doing it 20 plus years.
So about when I got to town in 1990, and it started, I guess, around back then.
It really did. It may have been before that, but it didn't become more noticeable until after that time.
Shortly after I got to town, somehow I got involved in helping somebody dispose of an estate, which was something I had no experience with. And then I discovered you did that all the time. So I kind of stepped on your territory there, but you did not complain.
Not at all, because there's a lot of factors involved, and the primary factor is the family, okay? Some people want to move fast for an estate sale or finding home for the equipment. Other people value the equipment almost as much as they do the person who used it. And therefore, they may not find out or even seek help for some time. Where others may have a house to sell or something like that, and they're on a time frame, therefore they seek help immediately. So it varies.
Is there a typical year? How many of these you'll do in an average year?
It could be as many as a dozen. It could be from one piece of equipment to several, but it could be that way. And it runs in spurts. There may be two or three or four in a month, and then you'll go two or three or four months with nothing.
And is there a typical estate in terms of the ham equipment? You just do the ham equipment, right?
Right.
You're not going to sell the
living
room furniture.
No, I let those folks take care of the other stuff. I do the ham equipment. If they're like a rifle inventory involved or something else, I may try to find somebody who's of like mind that they could lead somebody to find homes for equipment. But amateur radio is my thing.
And you're not looking for business out of Oregon or California. You're in Raleigh, North Carolina, and you help people around here.
That's true. But I have, I would say specifically, mostly the greater Raleigh area. However, I have been called from as far away as 150 to 175 miles, particularly down the eastern part of North Carolina, where for some reason a lot of hams retire to. And if they are using their equipment and their family may not even know their ham friends, then they start trying to put feelers out as to who might help them.
Yeah. So you're actual help is not available worldwide.
Right.
But we can give people the benefit of your expertise here. And I suppose you'd maybe take a phone call if somebody says, how do you really do this?
I would be glad to discuss it.
So is there a typical ham estate? I mean, do we tend to collect the same kinds of stuff in the same amounts, or is it all over the map?
It really is all over the map, because what you find is that if a ham has been currently active, say within the last year or two, then he's probably got some fairly modern equipment if he is of a mind to. Others may not have touched their amateur radio equipment in 10 or 20 years. Therefore, it's been sitting in an attic or a garage or someplace. So you don't know what you're going to face. One of the biggest things, I think, is just the space that the equipment takes up when it gets right down to it. And they have to decide how important is the space versus keeping sentimental equipment around.
And you were saying that sometimes the family doesn't know the rest of the hams in the area. The ham's experience as a ham is kind of insulated from the rest of the family.
Exactly. The one thing about amateur radio is really you can enjoy your hobby without necessarily sharing it with your family and other friends other than maybe other hams.
Yeah. I mean, it would be nice if you did, but the reality is a lot of us, our ham activity
exactly
separates us from the rest of the world.
Well, and some hams would prefer to be on a microphone and talking to some place 500, 1,000, or around the world, which doesn't put them in much contact with the local population, ham or otherwise. So there's so many different facets of amateur radio that depending on how important it is for the family activity to enjoy it is different from each case.
Okay, so a ham has died. The family contacts you. What do you do?
Usually what happens is I don't necessarily get a call myself. The contacts mainly come through the Raleigh Radio Club officers or members of the Raleigh Club who know that I do this kind of thing.
All right. So you've been contacted, but what's your next step?
Okay, the next step is usually to I have information for who and a telephone number. I'll call them, introduce myself, and saying, how can I help you? What would you like to do? So I get a feeling as to what the family intentions are. Most of the families have no idea the value of the equipment, absolutely none. And they don't know whether it'll bring a nickel or $500 in many cases, extremely. So I usually try to set up a personal appointment with them. And I'll say, okay, rather than inconvenience you for people to maybe come over to your house and go through the equipment and then have to wheel and deal with prices and so forth, I'll usually come over, look the equipment over, usually take what I think is worthwhile in the ham community and tell you what you can probably just trash. So that's what
that
what
may
happens.
Be a really key point for a lot of people, because I mean, we treasure our stuff. We have a real hard time getting rid of stuff because maybe I'm going to have to use that someday. You have to be pretty ruthless, I would imagine, in determining what's valuable enough to even bother trying to sell, much less get a lot of money for.
Well,
and what you tell people, I'm sorry, there's no value here, not even to come pick it up, so just toss it out.
Yeah, and one thing you kind of hope for is that there's not a big volume of equipment. Some hams were real tinkerers in their day, and therefore you can have a lot of boxes of components, tubes, coils, miscellaneous parts, which today has kind of fallen out of disfavor with most of the ham community. There are still pockets of people who like to experiment, but by far and away, it's whole pieces of equipment that are worth something.
And those people looking for the components and the little parts are going to be hard to find, hard to transport equipment to, and the value is still probably not very much there.
If I know of some friends in the radio club, for example, that might be interested in something that I see come my way from the States, then I might contact them. But I am not of a mind that I want to carry boxes of component parts to Hamfest after Hamfest to get 5 or 10 cents on the dollar.
Yeah, and if you're doing 10 or 12 or 15 of those a year, you can't
I don't like to keep the equipment around. There's a key point here that some people like to go in and offer a price for an entire estate. The only problem there is that you, as the buyer in this case, would not really know how much you're going to get out of it. So if you take it on as a consignment and assure the people that you're going to treat it as if it was your own equipment, you would check it out within reason and can speak to it, you hope you will get as high a dollar for it that I could get for them. Okay, and usually they are more than happy with that.
So you're not offering things at fire sale prices? Are they? Are you trying to hit the market?
Unless I get the feeling that there's no real market there. If I get something that I thought might be good, but after going out two or three times or mentioning to people, I can find out pretty much how soon I'm going to run across somebody will want it.
You are a motivated seller, but not a desperate one.
Exactly.
Okay. How do you find the value for all these pieces? I guess by now you've built up a lot of expertise.
Well, that's what happens. I observe different resources. There's several amateur classified networks, websites on the web that you can get what's selling and what they're asking for them. Doesn't mean that they're going to get those prices, but you get an idea where it is. And putting these together, even eBay, although I do not sell equipment on eBay, you can use it as a rough guide, and that's all I use it for.
You'll know at least the maximum price something's going to get. The unlikely maximum.
Yeah.
It's sort of like a list price, you know, at a retail dealer. You know, no one's ever going to pay that, but you know you're not going to pay more than that.
Right.
All right. Do you have any advice for people that are, we're losing your microphone there. Do you have any advice for people who are asked to do something like this and perhaps they don't have the experience, it's maybe their first time? What should they think they're going to have to do?
Well, the first thing you really need to do is gain their trust that you are looking out for the family's best interest. And that can be done a number of ways, but it's just being using the golden rule. That's the way I like, and I think that's a good way for folks to treat them. So, you know, you put yourself in their place. If somebody was trying to sell your equipment, your family was trying to sell their equipment, what would you expect them to do? They need to gain confidence. So, to answer your question, I would first try to gain their confidence, let them know that you'd be glad to help them, and we want to make sure that they're happy with the way things go. Can we sit down and have a talk and look over what you have? And then we can decide together how best to dispose of it.
Where do you go to sell things? Mostly hamfests?
Mostly hamfests. It depends on what it is.
This gets you to a lot of hamfests.
Well, it does. And I've actually been a little more selective about how many hamfests I go to. I may even wait to accumulate enough to make it worth my while. I have some other things to do on some weekends too besides hamfests, says me and my family. So I usually accumulate. I will, our local club has a classified section on their website. I at times put equipment out there as a feeler to see what kind of local interest there are. But I enjoy hamfests and I like the one-on-one being able to discuss the equipment, the pros and cons, because what you find a lot of times, people looking for used equipment are often newcomers or new to the hobby, and very often I feel the used equipment that comes up is not necessarily the best equipment to put in newcomers' hands. Some of it is 15, 20, 30 years old, and although it may be good working condition at that time or even currently, it has a lot more adjustments and idiosyncrasies to it than most newcomers would appreciate. So I kind of have to judge.
So don't take an FT-101 and try to sell it to a ham who's been licensed for 3 months.
Exactly.
The families that you deal with, are they, is this this ham radio stuff? I mean, ham radio is not always a friend in the family. You know, sad to say, you know, and that's part of the reason why perhaps that the ham the ham activity is kind of isolated from the rest of the family is that it not only do people not care that much, kind of an annoyance. Right. So now they've got all this stuff to deal with.
Exactly.
Do you run into that kind of, this is just a pain, get rid of it?
Yes, at times. At times. Oftentimes, if somebody's been in the hobby a good while, then the family has come to at least tolerate it. I can remember one family that had stuff, had antennas mounted along the garage walls. They had empty boxes and full boxes in an attic. But the ham passed away in June, and it was going to be July and August, and the attic was steaming hot, and they weren't about to go to the attic to get that stuff. So I actually was invited back in late October and picked up the rest of it and found a home for it. And the families usually don't worry about a time frame of disposal. And I tell them this right up front, that there's no guarantee as to when I'm going to find a home for all this equipment. I've been fortunate to be probably looking from the outside faster than might be expected, but I'd rather not make anybody too optimistic. And most families are not waiting with bated breath to get the proceeds of the ham radio equipment.
As I think you mentioned, they don't, for the most part, have a clue what the value is. I mean, Riley Hollingsworth told a great joke at a Dayton Hamvention. He said, if you ever hear that I'm dead, which fortunately for us he's not, get to my house in Gettysburg as fast as you can, because I've told my wife that everything here costs about $150. I guess that's the question. They don't have a good idea of the value. Are they surprised how much some of this might be worth?
Very often they are, because if in their own mind they think that, well, you know, maybe we'll get $300 or $400 out of it, and I can give them a check for $500 or $600 or $700, they are overwhelmed with thankfulness.
Yeah.
They really are.
So not only have you lifted the burden of disposing something that they don't know what it is, but they're making more money from it than they maybe thought they were going to.
Exactly. A lot of perceptions.
Run into anything on the other side where people have an unrealistic value, a perception of what the value is?
The only time that you might run into this, and I tend to shy away from these circumstances, and that is if there's an estate, but there are some ham friends or hams in the family who think they know what they should get for the equipment, okay? But they don't want to take the time to go and sell it to find out really what they'll get. But if they feel that way, if I get the feeling that there's quite a bit of pressure from people who think they know what it is, I would just as soon back out.
You don't need all that much help.
That's right. Exactly right. I'm not trying to be selfish, but on the other hand, it's hard to run a business when somebody else is trying to tell you how to run it or what the expectations are.
Yeah, and they don't perhaps realize you've really got the experience. You know what you're doing.
Yeah, I most of the time don't know most of these people. I mean, the people who I've ended up with oftentimes, they'll call club officers. But they either, the hams were sometimes not even members of the club, or they're from a town a few miles away, and we don't know anybody, so we thought we'd call you because your telephone number was on the website. Can you help us?
Yeah.
And that's how I get referrals.
Do you find things are difficult to dispose of? Are there things that you thought would be easy and that end up very hard to sell?
Pieces now and then are that way, but I try to, when it comes to that, when I start to get a feeling as to, okay, I've priced some stuff and I'm at a ham fest and I see that there's not that much interest, then I have to decide it's because we've just missed the wrong group of people in their interest, or really is it priced to a point where they don't want to even talk about it. So I might go through one ham fest and not sell some stuff, but by the time the next ham fest comes around, I will have done more checking on the internet, find out what prices are, and adjust accordingly, knowing that I don't want to carry that stuff for 6 months, 9 months. I don't go that way. I prefer to move it within 3 months.
Yeah.
That's my target.
And your experience is you have gotten reasonable prices for most of the things you're
That's
selling
right.
in
I've
that
been
amount
very
of
fortunate.
Time. Have you had any, I think I know of one, just absolutely huge estate, a collector, We're thinking of Tim, right? W4TIM. And you did you do that all by yourself? Did you have help?
No. A fellow that used to be very good friends with Tim Buhlman, W4TIM, by the name of Bob Keys, NA4G, was his very good friend. And together, they did many ham fests and collected a lot of real antique, amateur, and other equipment.
Yeah, Tim had a garage full and a house full. Just it was massive, and he always wanted to do a museum or do some kind of showplace. Never really did that. It was just collected on shelves.
That's right.
So he died fairly unexpectedly.
Right.
And what do you do with something that massive?
Well, that was an experience in itself. I'd never handled something like that. Bob Keys, the gentleman I mentioned, he was contacted by the family almost immediately when it happened because they knew the family knew of him. And so Bob, knowing me, connected with the radio club, said, "Chuck, I know about this stuff, but how do we go about finding a home for it all? Where do we go?" So that's when I became a partner in that project, okay? And so what we ended up doing was putting the word out to a number of antique radio enthusiasts, and they actually came to the deceased's house, even with a trailer or two, and took stuff away. And so we did business on the front end when the word got out, with these people would come and we'd sell the stuff right out of off the shelves. And so we did that to a point. And then we got rid of X amount of stuff. And then we had an antique, Central Carolina's Antique Wireless Association conference in Charlotte, which is an annual thing in March. And they have an auction.
And by the way, the subject of a previous Ham Radio Now podcast, so go back and look at that.
It would be
a couple of episodes
event.
Ago.
Anyway, they have an auction, and it was recommended by the folks connected with that association that we ought to take everything that's left and put it up to the auction block. All right? So we actually drove a budget rent-a-truck with all the other stuff.
We are talking about a huge estate.
That's right. And I'm going to give you a number so you'll... Now you can say, well, how many pieces does that number represent? Which, that's difficult, but hundreds of pieces, okay? A lot of antique stuff. In fact, one piece by itself brought like $15,000.
Yeah, he did not collect junk.
No, he didn't. He knew what was valuable. And bottom line, the auction for just his equipment brought almost $70,000. Now that's extraordinary, okay? But...
Suddenly people have those dollar signs rolling up in their eyes. Yeah, I think I've got about that much worth. I only paid $2,000 for it, but it's appreciated, hasn't it?
Well, he collected estate stuff, too. I mean, and he knew where
he
the
took
old
it home.
Stuff was. So it just goes on and on, you know. But, yeah, the day of reckoning came, and that's what the family got out of that business.
But so that was extremely extraordinary.
Right.
And I think I've asked, is there a typical, is it one or two pieces, five or ten?
If you forget
a couple
the
of VHF rigs, a couple of HF rigs.
Well, I tell you, if they were in the game a long time, typically there's very, very little UHF and VHF gear.
Really?
Most of the people that I've seen the last few years really didn't dabble in VHF, UHF that much. They had usually HF rigs that were anywhere from 5 to 40 years old. That's the typical stuff. Plus some power supplies, SWR accessories, microphones. There's a lot of typical stuff, like D104 mics are very popular back in yesteryear. Mm-hmm. I still got one of those I've held on to myself. But anyway.
Speaking of which, do you ever get, I got to have that for myself. Does your wife let you ever take something on?
As long as something moves out before the new comes in, yes. But I obviously, in this position, I have an eye to see what comes in. If it looks interesting, then I certainly cannot turn it away.
I see you becoming a pack
I rat. Become a consumer, too.
Yeah.
But I would say probably 85 to 90% of what comes my way from this source goes out.
That still leaves you with a lot of stuff. Your basement must be pretty
full. Well,
fun.
Not really. It may come in bigger pieces, fewer.
And stuff does move back out.
That's right.
Eventually. And you you charge a little bit for this, or whether you take a percentage or...
Yes, and this has not been an issue with any of my folks that I've worked with, but I charge 15% off the top of whatever I get for any of this stuff. And basically the 15% takes care of HamFest admissions, tickets, gas, taking time to check radios out, assembling manuals that are missing, put them in decent folders, make the equipment and any accessories more saleable. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's worth everybody's time, because on the bottom line, you get a few more bucks for it if you know what people like to see in a package.
Yeah.
And packages often do better than individual items.
Is there anything that a ham who is still alive at this point and watching the podcast, I guess,
certainly are,
can do in preparation for the time when they're gone? And you know, the sad fact is men die typically before women do. Hams are more often than not men, which means we are going to be leaving our wife and our heirs with this stuff. Is there anything we can do well before that sad event to prepare things for the step that you then walk in and take over?
Yeah, there
but
is.
No one ever does.
Well, that's the point. If a ham enjoys having his things around most of the time, even if he doesn't really use them that much, they are part of him, just like any other pack rat, if you want to go that way. So as far as preparing, my suggestion is that you should, as a family member, the non-ham, or another ham in the family that might be younger and still be around, and is not knowledgeable and wants help, you should really get to know some people that maybe the ham knew and trusted or was friends of. Because what you want is somebody that you feel comfortable with coming in your house, going through your stuff, and handling your proceeds as you wish. And the proceeds is another angle on this. So the preparation really comes down to, I even know a ham who actually sold everything he had except one HF transceiver, one microphone, and one antenna, knowing that his day was inevitable. But that is the rare exception for someone to feel that concerned about cleaning house and being ready for the later time. So that's the way to go, is to get to know any local ham, even one or two that your ham was friends with or knew of, or even a radio club. Going to the president or an officer of the radio club is as good a chance of getting some help that you could be confident with.
I suppose some of us, if we're not that monetarily driven, we could just designate who we want our equipment to go to.
Yeah, you could. That's almost a personal thing. I mean, if the ham knows or the family knows some other people, like maybe they know a family that has some young hams in it and feel that they want that equipment to go to them. As far as I'm concerned, I could facilitate that, but I would not get involved. I would prefer them to work on that rather than me be a third party. Now, if they wish me to get involved, I will do what I can. But when it comes to negotiation...
It's getting noisy here.
Noisy. So. Okay. Yes, okay. I really would let them carry it unless I can really help them, and I kind of judge that.
Okay. Well, yeah, you wouldn't necessarily be in the middle of it, but just give... Now that people are thinking about it, and this is things I doubt very many of us have thought of very much, unless we're really close to the end, but we never know. You know, could step out of the ham fest today and get hit by a bus. Would it help to collect receipts or you know, keep the manuals together, all that stuff, things in good condition?
That's a good point. There's a number of things. In the equipment, the manuals are very important. Now, in much of the equipment, you can get manuals online. But
yeah, that's probably made your job easier over the past
five or six years. It has at times, but I can tell you, particularly on some of the older stuff, an original manual adds a great deal of genuineness to the whole thing.
How about boxes and packing material?
Yes, the boxes that the equipment came in.
Because my wife always wants me to throw them away.
Well, I got an attic full of empty boxes that I haven't thrown out, stuff that I don't have anymore for one reason or another. But
she's got the box.
That's right. I've got the box, and I've actually given some boxes to friends who, for some reason, say they wanted to send their equipment back to a repair shop, and they needed a box that would fit what they had. Usually, you have to double box stuff at least.
Yeah.
And if you hold on to your original boxes, you're in great shape. But the price is space. So you may or may not have it.
Yeah. Okay, so it'd be helpful to keep the manuals, keep right. the boxes.
One place, someplace in a drawer, labeled if you
would
can.
Would you care about an inventory? I mean, the new price, about irrelevant.
Yeah. An inventory is okay, but my experience is that unless the ham, who's passed away, is very judicious in his bookkeeping, he will not have done that. And the families haven't done that, and they usually don't worry about it. If there's 10 items, they don't really know necessarily how much that's worth. So I basically say, I will take that. I think they're valuable to one person or another, and I will do the best I can with it. I'll check it out. I'll do the best on the whole thing. And we don't even get into inventory. Now, that varies. Some people are very cautious. And they will offer, and I've even actually had a sign off on an inventory of the stuff I took. But that has been a rare exception. They're more interested in finding a home for it, getting as best you can, and being done with it. And the end result is, if you get X dollars for the whole thing, after all is said and done, a net figure, then they have a choice of what they want to do with the money. They can either use the money for family needs, or maybe they've said, the ham was very close to the radio club. We would like to donate all of the proceeds from his radio equipment to the radio club, or even a percentage of the proceeds.
Yeah, and that happens more often than you might think.
Yes.
I mean, every year, the radio club that we're in, the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society, receives several $1,000s worth of donations from hams who have passed away and left us part of their estate, just saying, thanks for everything we got from being in the club.
There's a point here that should probably be made is our radio club really does not have a place to store amateur radio equipment. And some people are under the impression that if they just donate equipment, lock, stock, and barrel, to a club, then the club will go and store it and bring it out any old time and find a home for
it. That's a headache for the club, not
exactly,
not a benefit.
It's a headache for the club. This is kind of where I came in. What I do is I, in effect, represent the club's interests in finding a home for the radio equipment that they want to dispose of, and I tell them, we would be glad, the radio club would be glad to take a donation. And we are a 501c3 club, and we would be glad to give you a letter of receipt for the cash donation. And it makes it very simple.
I should mention, this is a club of 350, 400 members. You're not going to see this at a 25-member club. But it'll happen once in a while.
That's right. It varies. Depends on what the ham, the deceased, what he was involved in. If he really feels strongly that the local club should benefit, a lot of times they'll think the local club should benefit, and some will say, well, he was really interested in educating new hams, and therefore can't you use the money to support the new ham effort?
So they want to direct
they want to direct it, but I can tell you that from an accounting standpoint, legal, I found out, is that it's better to donate the money to a general fund as opposed to being specific, because when you're specific, then you got a lot more accountability to take care of, both
so
from a
trust person. Trust the club to do something good with it.
Exactly.
We should mention that the ARRL also does a lot of good things, and they have a program of being part of someone's will or someone's estate. So, you know, look for that too. Your local club is important. ARRL is important. So, you know, point something in that direction. Have you ever met anyone else who's done what you've done? Are you a lone wolf?
From my experience, Generally speaking, I'm a lone wolf, at least in this area. There are
You're going to get some email now.
A lot of times, another ham, member of the club or whatever, will be contacted by somebody. And there's no reason why they can't, if they want to, take the time to dispose of that equipment for them. If they refer it to me, so be it. If they don't, then I don't go after it, and I say, okay, that's your business. You take care of it however you wish. They may know the family personally and take care of it.
We're being watched worldwide here. People watch this podcast from around the country and around the world. And you've never heard of anyone else who specializes in doing this. There's got to be somebody else out there who does.
Okay. From that standpoint, I think you see a number of businesses that advertise an interest in buying estates. Okay. Now, to me, we know that they're really serious about buying estates, low dollar, and making a decent buck on it.
Yeah,
okay.
And it's not because they're greedy. It's because that's what they have to do.
Well, that's their business, it's a hobby or whether it's...
I mean, they may be greedy, but the odds are they're not as greedy as we think they are. We're all greedier than we think we are. Right. But in terms of individuals, just hams that somehow have fallen into doing this. You haven't been contacted
met
anybody else.
At the Ham Fest, I see people that got a quantity of HF transceivers, for example, but in quizzing them a little bit, I find that they've bought them here and they bought them there and they bought them there at a price and they're turning a buck and so forth. So the number of people who have gone it just as what I like to think of as a service are very few and far between.
Interesting. And you do more than I expected. I've known you've done many, but I thought it would be two or three a year, and the number, 6 to 12 a year is two, three times what I thought you'd probably done, and I see you do this all the time. It is extremely, extremely valuable, and I imagine you're going to be hearing from, you're going to get calls and email from people all over the country that want you to do it for them, and you're not going to. You can't. But you're also going to get calls from people who say, how do I do it? What's my next step? And as much as we've outlined the steps here, people are still going to ask. They'll have more questions. So
I'll be glad to help if I can.
Yep. Send email probably better than phone calls.
That would be better.
Okay.
Call sign at ARL.net.
Yep. K4HF@ARL.net. We'll splash that all over
the
interview.
Right.
People will find you. Well, thanks, Chuck. Have I missed anything? Is there anything
I think there's a lot of folks that are in need out there. You never know when it's going to pop up.
By the way, do you operate only CW? Because your microphone technique is just terrible.
Yes. Very
right.
little phone.
All right. So any last tips that I haven't covered I haven't asked you about?
I think you've been very thorough. And as I say,
annoyingly thorough,
any,
as usual.
About the questioning. And I think if anybody does have questions, I'd be welcome to share your thoughts.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Something to think about, something to do. And that's it for this two-part episode of Ham Radio Now. If you want to support the podcast, you can do it by stopping by our website, hamradionow.tv. Click on Arvin. Yeah, come on in, Arvin. Yeah, just help me out here. Click on Arvin the Pig, and you'll go to a page where you can make a contribution, whatever amount that you want, whatever you think the program is worth to you. And I thank you very much for that. For now, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, along with the bear and the mouse, 73, over and out.